Check. Can you hear me? Wonderful. Hey, everybody. Welcome to a concert. If you don't know me personally, my name is Chris McCurdy. I'm the new instrumental music director here at Grant, and I've been loving my time for the last month and a half. Our first ensemble up here is the percussion ensemble. We're just going to get right into it, because there's a lot of groups tonight. The percussion ensemble has been working with me for the last month and a half on a lot of rudimental snare and pep band percussion. So rudimental snare is just the idea of your sticks doing lots of different things. A rudiment's basically just a small snippet of music that we use a lot. Think of it like a small Lego brick going into a larger Lego piece. These guys have been great. I have students that don't read any music yet and students that have been reading music their whole lives. And it's a really fun class to teach because of that. We've had a lot of really great student mentors in the program so far, and Noah has been that student mentor for us here. We've got two selections. The first one is a rudimental etude, duet between a bass drum and a snare drum, and we're just gonna all be on snare and bass. Noah's gonna come up to the center here and explain what this rudiment is all about. It's about a five-stroke roll.
Awesome. A five-stroke roll is just a way to make the drum sound like it's lasting forever. It's just playing the drumsticks really fast. It's the same thing as...
any more shots in the hall like we talked about today. And he's going to count us off for our roll. Go. Thing we're going to do is we're going to just play a couple of the pep band licks we've been looking at. If you've ever been to a football game, you're going to hear the drum line play a ton. They play a lot just between plays, and they do a great job of keeping the energy up. We've got three of our selections tonight, and Noah is going to call them, and we're going to play them. Here we go. While they're switching, I think you all have heard about the QR code on the back of the program. Don't do it yet, there'll be time. But if you haven't done it, we need to know what seat you're sitting in and all the people that are in your party. So if you haven't filled that out, we'll have some time during some of the longer transitions to get that done. But this is just for our contact tracing purposes.
AC/DC.
Thank you.
more round of applause for our percussion ensemble. We'll have a brief set change, and then we'll be right back with you. Stop using the microphone for a sec. This is our jazz lab. This is the entrance level jazz lab we have here at Grant. We've got students of all different experience levels and ages in this group. That's what kind of makes it fun. We've got two charts for you. Both of them are the shuffle style, which we've been working on all for the last 4 weeks, accentuated by triplet eighth notes and a driving quarter note. So here is Back on Life.
One, two.
So this is our jazz ensemble. This is the top group as far as jazz is concerned here at Grant. And selfishly, jazz is my thing. I really love doing it. My dad and I grew up listening to it in the car. And it's got a really big place in my heart. These kids are very good. Very good. There's a very good jazz program here, and this is what happens when you work all the way up through it. It's been a pleasure working with them. Selfishly, I get to play all of my favorite tunes again because I'm at a different school now, so this is kind of like McCurdy's greatest hits, which is great, and I get to do them all over again, and the sound is completely different, and I'm really enjoying doing this. So, I wrote myself this down. We're going to start with Moten Swing. You're going to hear Jackson on piano, Anthony on tenor, and Paul on trumpet. Here's Moten Swing. right. That was a great bassy chart arranged by Quincy Jones, and we heard from Anthony on tenor. Am I missing anybody? I don't think so. Great. Our last chart is by Duke Ellington, and Duke Ellington is, in my opinion, the greatest composer from America that ever has been. He's one of my favorite. Oh, yeah, sure, we can clap for Duke. Let's do it. His music is like the college level of jazz rep. He wrote for individual voices, so every part is equally important, and every part needs to have its own color. He also did a lot of different compositional things, so it's not as in like a bassy chart where you'd be seeing a lot of the same style and that kind of stuff. He does a lot of really good to and fro as far as style's concerned. So this is Harlem Airshaft. You'll hear some Benny Goodman trumpet lines that have been in, and I think you guys are gonna really enjoy it. Soloing on Harlem Airshaft is Liam on trombone, Kai, and we'll hear Anthony one more time on tenor. Here's Harlem Airshaft.
Thank you. Italian composer Antonio Vivaldi famously said, "There are no words, there is only music." And yet, ironically, Vivaldi's best-known work, Le Quattro Stagioni, The Four Seasons, is based upon a series of sonnets. Vivaldi's The Four Seasons concludes with biting winds and idyllic images by the fire. Imagine the brisk chill of winter upon you in the joyful first movement, shivering, frozen mid the frosty snow in biting, stinging winds, running to and fro to stamp one's icy feet, teeth chattering in the bitter chill. The runs in the solo violin perfectly encapsulate the brisk chill found in the air. In contrast, the second movement transfers indoors to rest contently by the hearth while those outside are drenched in the pouring rain. These concerti can arguably be considered among the first truly pragmatic pieces, that is, music that tells or follows a narrative. Although Vivaldi composed a great range of genres, his concerti endure as one of his greatest contributions to the Western classical canon. Thank you.
Check. Oh, now it's here. The string orchestra is in front of you. I have had an absolute joy teaching strings. I hope it didn't sound like it, but this is my first year teaching strings. I'm a saxophone player, and it's been a really cool, like, symbiotic back and forth thing. Music is music, and I'm taking violin lessons from a friend, but these people have helped me day one. They're helping me with what the heck does this sign mean, what the heck does that sign mean, and I've been helping them with this is how you turn a phrase, etc. So it's been a really great class to be a part of, and I've really enjoyed every moment. Also, I have jazz ensemble right in the beginning of the day, and they like melt my face off, and then I get to have this sweet string orchestra right afterwards, and it's very calming. So Rainer is going to come up and talk about our next piece.
Holst became good friends with Clifford Bass, who was an astrologer. From there, in 1914, Holst began to craft a seven-movement suite with movements entitled Mars, the Bringer of War, Venus, the Bringer of Peace, Mercury, the Winged Messenger, Jupiter, the Bringer of Jollity, Saturn, the Bringer of Old Age, Uranus, the Magician, and Neptune, the Mystic. Why not Pluto? Pluto was not discovered until 1930. The plant as a whole displays Holst's compositional strengths and influences. His ability to write flowing melodies in the style of English folk songs, yet utilize the contemporary styles of Schoenberg and Stravinsky, showed his talents and musical convictions like never before. His fourth movement, Jupiter, Bringer of Jollity, offers three memorable themes, including the rich and soaring hymn-like section featured in Miss Monday's arrangement.
Thank you. Gioachino Rossini was perhaps the most influential Italian composer of his generation. By the time he was 37 years old, he had written 37 operas, 34 of which had been produced within 14 years. Rossini raised comic opera to a new and unsurpassed heights, and also laid the foundations of the Italian romantic opera of the mid-19th century. Among the best known of Rossini's compositions are William Tell and the comic opera, The Barber of Seville. It is interesting to note that the overture contains none of the themes found in the opera, because it was actually written for two earlier operas. The overture of this opera encompasses a wide range of music, from delicate to lyrical to determined to furious. Surviving a disastrous opening night in Rome, the opera went on to become one of Rossini's most popular works.
Thank you.
All right, before you, while they're getting set up, is Symphonic Band. Symphonic Band, yes. Hey, Symphonic Band, how many of you for this is your first high school show? Raise your hand. Very good. We've had a great time together. We started the year really, really fast with Pep Band, and then we put all this together probably in, what, 2 weeks, 2.5 weeks? They've done great. They're awesome kids. I've loved meeting new personalities and learning new quirks and what everybody's fun things to talk about are. We've been working on a couple band classics and then some balance blend chorale stuff. So we're gonna take a couple tuning notes and then we will get right into it. Do you have enough room? You got enough room? Oh, one more time? Keep up. Ready? Everybody, welcome Noam to the microphone to read us about Flourish.
Ralph Van Williams, a highly respected English composer, wrote some of the earliest works for the 20th century concert band, with many of his pieces considered pillars for band literature. Flourish for Wind Band was written as an overture for the pageant Music and the People performed in the Royal Albert Hall in 1939. The score was then lost, only to reappear in 1971. It was not made available to American bands until it was published in 1972. Flourish for Wind Band followed on the heels of Van Williams' great masterworks for band, English Folk Song Suite and Toccata Marziale, and is significant in part because it is relatively easy work by a composer of high stature and skill.
Thank you. Frank Erickson's Air for Band is an early career work written in 1956. He later, in 1966, revised it to fit standard band instrumentation and part divisions. In writing Air for Band, Erickson was preoccupied with creating a piece that young students could perform, could successfully perform, that was also of educational value. The desire to create melodically interesting works of pedagogical merit was a goal shared by a growing list of composers at that time. In Air for Band, Erickson favored simple and harmonically uncomplicated ideas that are playable, interesting, and to him, musically worthwhile. The form of the piece is a modified song form AABACB, wherein the C section acts as a bit of development, and the second B section moves into a new key to serve as the coda. Please enjoy.
Thank you. On June 29, 1962, Life magazine featured Aaron Copland's composition of Down the Country Lane. The piece was commissioned by Life in hopes of making quality music available to the common pianist and student. The work was featured along with an article titled Our Bumper Crop of Beginning Piano Players. The article explains, Down the Country Lane fills a musical gap. It is among the few modern pieces especially written for young piano students with a major composer. Copland is quoted in the article saying, even third-year students will have to practice before trying it in public. Copland then explains the title. The music is descriptive, only in an imaginative, not literal sense. I didn't think of a title until the piece was finished. Down the Country Lane just happened to fit its flowing quality. Copland is very descriptive in his directions on how the piece should be played. The piece begins with the instructions to play gently, flowing in a pastoral mood. A brief midsection is slightly dissonant and to be played a trifle faster, and the ending returns to the previous lyrical mood. Down the Country Lane was orchestrated for inclusion in a youth orchestra series and premiered on November 20th, 1965 by the London Junior Orchestra. The band arrangement was composed by Merlin Patterson in 1988. Patterson specialized in Copland transcriptions. Copland himself spoke of Patterson's excellent work upon the completion of Down the Country Lane, saying that he has produced a careful, sensitive, and most satisfying extension of the mood and content of the original. Enjoy.
Thank you. Okay, awesome. Can we hear? Okay, great. Hi, I just wanted to say a few words before we close the close the concert with our last piece. My name is Amelia. I'm a senior this year, and this is my fourth year in band. And because it's my last year, it is my and many others' last fall concert, and it's also, this marks the beginning of our last season with Grant Band. And I just want to say that being able to start this season with an audience of people playing in person and just sharing this musical experience with everybody means the world to me and to so many other people. So thank you all so much for coming. Even though it is our last fall concert for the seniors, it's also a first for so many students and people. So as Mr. McCurdy kind of hinted at earlier, because we are online, pretty much all of our freshmen and sophomores have never really played a true live Grant Band performance before. So just a huge shout out to them. They're all doing wonderful. This concert, because of them, was really, really special. And then also, it is our first concert with our new band director, Mr. McCurdy. And yeah. So as many of you know, last year our old band director, Mr. McFadden, that was his last year at Grant, and we will always be incredibly grateful for everything he put into this program, especially over quarantine. But this past kind of month and a half for a lot of us has been a time when we're rediscovering what we love about music and rediscovering just how wonderful it is to create art with other people in person. And to be able to do that with such an incredible band director like Mr. McCurdy is just a real gift. So I just wanted to say on behalf of all the musicians here, thank you so much, Mr. McCurdy. We're so glad that you have joined our community, and welcome to the Grant Band family.
Everybody, that was so nice.
I'm super happy to be here. I really love being here. Many of you know that I live just up the street on Alberta, and it was really cool to have all these cards fall into place and wind up here. And I can't imagine a better group of kids to start with, and I'm just really excited for where we go in the future. And now that we can finally all be together, here's our last tune. It's called Requiem. We're gonna do four movements. So this is my beginning of the year tisk tisk for no clapping between movements, or the classical gods will smite you. Okay? Four movements, count them. If you lose count, don't clap, just wait. And lastly, I just want to thank everybody that's helped make my transition here really, really easy. From our performing arts staff, who have been helping me and fielding so many questions, text messages, everything. Thank you so much for all of your help. And then to our administrators as well. You guys have been working tirelessly throughout this whole year to make sure that our students stay safe, both in school and at events like this. And I just really appreciate it. I saw Mr. McGee running around like a chicken with his head cut off all day to make sure that this works. Mr. McGee, are you in the audience right now? I think I see you, Mr. McGee. Where are you? Stand up. And now that we've been all touchy-feely, after this tune, you all need to leave as soon as possible. Get out. Your students, for the most part, will come meet you outside. Wind Ensemble and I get to spend a nice little 20 minutes together striking the stage. But as far as you people are concerned, please leave. Thank you so much. Here's our last tune. This is Requiem, and Vivian is going to tell us a little bit about it.
Can you hear me? Tells us the title means dances, says Requiem is a suite in four movements based on Jewish dances, bearing in mind that these are not arrangements of existing folk music, but originally composed dances in the style of folk music. Though the use of oriental style tone intervals, irregular tempi, and typical woodwind instrumentation, the composer succeeds in both adding a touch of melancholy and a characteristically Jewish flavor to the music. The clearly marked themes and the sometimes surprising, but on the other hand, very natural harmonies make these stylized folk dances into music with a direct and gripping appeal.